Hey, this is wonderful to be together. I've had the greatest time the last few days hanging out with your pastor. He's taught me so much. He taught me how to shave. He has a pretty special way of shaving, and taught me how to shoot a turkey. And we've been just having so much fun together. And it's been great being with you, having a chance to meet many of you in the different meetings, leadership gatherings, and men's gathering, and just been a wonderful time. Where I'm the president of Elam Bible and Student College. Elam is a school dedicated to preparing Christ-centered, Spirit-empowered, selfless leaders for global revival. That's what we're all about. And we've been doing this job for 90 years, over 90 years, actually. Isn't that something? And I'm the seventh president in the history of the school, and it's quite a quite an amazing. Okay, good. Okay, quite an amazing story of all that's happened there. But of course, you know, over 90 plus years, you got to make some changes and improvements and strengthening. And one of the things that came as part of my assignment when I came 5 years ago, actually it'll be 5 years tomorrow, when I came 5 years ago, was to see the school become accredited. And it was quite an amazing process. All these years, they've been doing their job of training ministers for the nations, but not in an accredited way where they could get help from the government and students could and things like that. So it was my job to go after that. We went after that and successfully did that. Praise the Lord. We are the only accredited, Spirit-filled type school in all of New York State, and thank God for that. It's awesome. And our students are able to get Pell Grants and all kinds of things now, and we're just so thankful for that all coming together. So the getting of the accreditation, though, was very intense. After several years of work, they sent a team of people to the campus, college presidents and different kinds of leaders in academia, and they came in and they just sat with us for 3 days and took apart every aspect of the school to see where we were at and produced a report about that. And then we were going to go down to Dallas, Texas, and they before the accreditation commission, they ask you some questions. They interrogate you, and depending on how that goes, they make the decision on whether or not you're going to be accredited. Well, I'd never been through that kind of process before, and that was a little intimidating as I was down in Dallas, and we went into the room, and there were about 20 commissioners that were in the room. It looked like a government. You know those government things you see where like Congress has, where everybody has their own little microphone that they press the button and talk, you know, and they're interviewing the person, and that's the kind of deal this was. And so I walk into the room with a couple of my staff, and I sit down there, and the head lead commissioner tells me, he says, look, two people have studied your school intensely, two of the commissioners, and they are going to ask you some questions. He says, after they finish asking you the questions they're going to ask you, we're going to vote on whether or not to accept your school as an accredited school. So I, okay. And he said, the first commissioner is Dr. Benjamin Karanja. He points over at a handsome black man that's sitting by him, all suited up. And so here we go. We're ready to go. And the gentleman says, he says, let me ask you a question, he says, to begin. And I said, okay. And he says, are you the Elam? He has like an African lilt to his accent. He says, are you the Elam who has sent missionaries to Africa? And it just so happens that over that 90 years, one of the great mission fields of the world where Elam students were used in very powerful ways. Matter of fact, there's a whole movement of churches, 3,000-4,000 churches in Kenya that is the result. It's called Pentecostal Evangelical Fellowship of Africa, of Elam students and missionaries being there in Kenya. And so I said, yes. I said, as a matter of fact, I said, we are the Elam that has been quite heavily involved in Africa. And he said, well, he says, I am an Elam alumnus. And I thought, I knew he wasn't an Elam alumnus because I'm the president of the school, and if you were, I would know, you know, and somebody else who was also a president of a college. And so I said, sir, what do you mean by that? And he said 50 years ago, he said, I was in a village, a child in a village in Africa. He says, and an Elam young person came to that village and took all the children that were there and began to teach us the gospel. He says, I still have papers, he said, where I filled out, where I studied the Bible with this person, and I filled these things out that say Elam across the top. He said, so I consider myself an alumnus of Elam. Isn't that amazing? And, you know, yeah, it's think about it. 50 years before I'm standing in front of a commission to see whether or not the school will become accredited, 50 years before, God sends a young person, a graduate of our school, into a village, some remote village in Africa, where a little kid is being ministered to in that place, never knowing, that young person never knowing that that kid would eventually grow up to become the commissioner that would decide whether or not our school was going to become accredited. Come on. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? And, you know, you got to think about, you know, a lot of us, we think the devil is like the opposite of God. The devil is not the opposite of God. He is not all-powerful. He's not all-knowing. He's not almighty. He's not all anything. And he's limited. He must feel so hopeless in moments like that to know that God knew the future and 50 years before planned the whole thing out. You know, listen, that young person that went to Africa, there's a great likelihood that they were back in this remote village. Maybe they were asking themselves, what did I get myself into? Maybe they were hoping they were going to be a preacher in some huge revival crusade. Instead, they're sitting with a group of 10-year-old kids teaching them the Bible in the backwoods of Africa, some back village in Africa, never knowing that the investment that they were making would 50 years later make the kind of payoff that it did, that is having this profound impact on so many. And, you know, think about your life. You know, what is God doing through you? You know, things that you look at right now and you're thinking, well, maybe I'm not really doing too much. Maybe not much is happening, you know. But the fact is that conversation on the factory floor, that moment where you're parenting and going the extra mile and taking that step, that little effort you reach out to someone else, who knows 50 years from now what incredible impact is going to be had, all started by that little step, that little gesture, that little moment. It's amazing, isn't it? Yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing. Get some hope. Get some faith for the future, because God wants to stir you and inspire you. Well, I want to talk to you today on a subject, the subject of commitment.
Say it again.
Commitment. Say it again. Okay? The commitment. The power of commitment. I was trying to think of how to express this to you, and what does it really mean to commit to something, you know? And there were a couple thoughts that came to my mind. One thought that came to my mind was when you commit to something, there is no graceful way to turn back.
That's true.
You know, if you really commit to it, there's just no graceful way to turn back from it. It reminds me of when I was a kid. Maybe you remember moments like this. When I was in school, there would be a craze every few years that would kind of sweep through the school where a person would be going to sit in a chair, and just before they got there, somebody would pull the chair out from under them. Do you know? That doesn't happen in Michigan, does it? Okay. Pull the chair up, and boom, they go crashing down to the floor. And of course, if you knew that that was kind of happening in your school, you could kind of prepare yourself a little bit. And when you went to sit down, you would never really commit to the chair. You know, you'd kind of hold your muscles all together and kind of, until you felt chair, you didn't really give it everything you had, you know. But when you committed to the chair, when you believed the chair was going to be there, when you gave that chair your full weight, when you did that, folks, there is no graceful way to come back from that. You are going down if that chair is not there. Bam, just in that way. And that's, you know, that's one of the things about commitment. Another thing about commitment that came to my mind was there is no balance in commitment. You know, a person doesn't say, well, I'm a little committed to that idea. You can't be a little committed. You're either committed or you're not committed, right? You either are in or you're not in. You're either putting your weight on the chair or you're not putting your weight on the chair. It's something that doesn't have a little bit. You know, it can't be a little bit. It is or it isn't. Another thing that strikes me about commitment is commitment makes me vulnerable. Commitment makes me vulnerable. I'm a committed Buffalo Bills fan. Yeah, that makes me vulnerable all by itself, doesn't it? It's such a sad thing. All the football people here know what I'm talking about. But if you like to watch football, you'll have those moments when you're watching football where you'll see a receiver running across the field amongst all the opposing team, and the quarterback winds up to shoot the ball at that guy, and you see the guy. The guy knows he's in the middle of everybody. He knows that when he catches that ball, he is going to get smashed right in that moment. They're going to want to hit him so hard he drops the ball. That's what their goal is. They're going to hit him with everything. And you can see sometimes the look on the person's face as the ball is coming toward them, as they're making a decision. Am I going to commit to the ball, give everything I can to commit to the ball, or am I going to try to protect myself? And often if they choose to protect themselves, they miss the ball. They have to commit. They have to give it everything. But to commit means you become vulnerable in some kind of way. And a lot of us are afraid of that vulnerability. We don't want to be vulnerable. And so we greatly hesitate to commit. Commitment always cost me something. There's no such thing as a free commitment. When I commit to church, for example, today, you're here on Sunday morning, right? This is it. Sunday morning, you don't wake up and go, oh, what am I going to do today? You know, no, you're here in church. You've made a commitment to church to be a part of this thing. There are a lot of people doing lots of other things all over, you know, the place this morning, but you got up and you made a commitment, you know? It's not like every Sunday you wake up and you kind of go, okay, what do we want to do today? No, you have committed. We'll be here. As a matter of fact, some people have been here for many hours already today. Before church ever started, they were here getting things set up and put together and rehearsing and setting all those kind of things together. They paid a price to make this service happen for you. How about let's give a hand, a thank you to all those people who work to make church happen every day to come together in that kind of way. So what I want us to look at is, what is biblical commitment really all about? And I want us to look in a passage, Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14, right there. You can get your Bible or your cell phone where you have your Bible, or wherever you have your Bible. Luke chapter 14, and we're going to start with verse 25. Luke chapter 14, starting with verse 25. Now, let me set the context just a little bit for you, because in this passage, Jesus is being followed by a multitude of people. And Jesus is not a politician. Jesus is not interested in keeping the crowd. He loves people, but his heart is not engaged by men's applause. He's not linked into trying to please the crowd. But instead, he's in a place where he speaks to them the truth. And if the truth thins the crowd, he's willing to pay that price. Let's see what he says to him, because some of the things that he says are so shocking. You may have read them before, but never really thought about them. They're so shocking, they're so arresting, that you might actually doubt that they're Jesus' words themselves. Here's what he says, verse 25. It says, "Now great multitudes were going along with him, and he turned and said to them, 'If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple.'" Now, if there's ever a verse that you might be sitting there going, somebody made a mistake, because this isn't Jesus. Jesus loves families, right? Right? Jesus is, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. I mean, it's like shocking, isn't it? Can you imagine if you were in that crowd, all looking at your wife, looking at your children, looking at your mother? And what would you think of Jesus in that moment? Remember, this whole passage that we're looking at is Jesus talking about commitment. And what he's trying to say here is this, that even in the realm of relationships, there are some relationships, human relationships, that literally will not function unless you have prioritized Jesus Christ number one in your life. That is, if in your mind you come, and the Bible is full of stories, pictures of people who loved their children, for example, more than God, or they loved things more than God. If you have, in the area of relationships, if you have any other relationship, even your parents, even your mother, if you have any relationship that you love more than you love God, that literally can cause the whole relational system to break down. Let me give you an illustration of what I'm talking about. If you think about the issue of parenting, right? What about if you love your child more than you love God? If you're a parent, every parent has had a discussion that's gone something like this. Kid comes to you and says, Daddy, I'm so excited. There's going to be a big party Friday night. Everybody is going to it. It's okay if I go to it, right? Okay, tell me about this party. Okay, well, this is going to happen at the party, and this is going to happen, and so-and-so's going, and so-and-so's going, and so-and-so's parents are letting them go. Is it okay if I go to the party, Daddy? And Daddy thinks and looks at this thing, this situation, and he says, I don't really feel good about this. This doesn't sound like where I want you to be. Daddy, what do you think? Say you can't do this. Don't you realize if I don't go to this party that my whole experience at school is going to be destroyed? People are going to think I'm a dweeb. Please, Daddy. Well, I'm sorry, honey. I'm not sure that this is. I'm not. I just don't feel right that it's the right thing for you to do. Daddy, everybody is doing it. Please. Daddy, well, everybody may be doing it, but I'm not sure you're doing it this Friday night. Oh, Daddy, Daddy, I hate you! Turn and slam the door. Bam, right? Anybody ever have a little interaction like that? Okay. Now, here's the deal. If I love my child more than God, when that door slams, something inside of me goes, oh, and I run up to the door. Oh, honey, don't be mad at Daddy. We'll work out a way for you to go. We'll make it so you can go. I'm willing to sacrifice my child on the altar of my need for love. Are you with me? To put them in a place where they should not be, because I can't bear for them not to keep me in the center of their heart for a moment, and not be willing to be the parent that I need to be, right? Why? Because I love them more than I love the purposes of God and love God and his will for their lives and all the things that are happening there. Are you following me? Okay, so he's saying to us something. He's saying, look, relationships don't work unless they're in the right order. If these things are not in the right order, the right priority, everything gets distorted. So you have to commit first to me above every other relationship. And then he goes on, verse 27. He says, whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Now, remember now, when Jesus is saying carry his own cross, the cross is not a religious symbol in front of the church or something that sits on a steeple or a little gold piece of jewelry that a pretty girl wears around her neck. A cross is not any of those things at this time. The cross is a symbol of execution. The cross is when a person has done something that society has decided is so terrible that they will take him outside the city and hang him up on a cross or her up on a cross as an example to the whole region, the whole area of the wrongness, right? Tie him up there, nail him up there, do whatever they have to do to. If you saw a person carrying a cross, you would not want to be identified with that person, right? I've been on the streets of Jerusalem, the narrow streets of the old city, and you can imagine yourself if you were standing on that street and a group of Roman soldiers with a man that was carrying a cross was coming down the street. You would press yourself up against the wall, trying to get away from what was going on. The last thing in the world that you would want Because that man was a person of no reputation. The last thing in the world that you would want would be to be identified with that. You know, the last thing, can you imagine the person coming along and they stumble a little bit and then they look over at you and go, hi, hi, Bill. You know, you would be like, ah, I don't know him. You know, I mean, what? I don't want to be identified with that person, right? Because that person is a person of no reputation, see? And so he's speaking here. He's saying, whoever is not willing to be that person of no reputation, whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And then he says, for which one of you, when he wants to build a tower, these are red letters, Jesus' words, does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if he has enough to complete it. Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who observe it begin to ridicule him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. He says, look, I'm not looking. He's looking at this crowd. He's going, I'm not looking for you to make some kind of emotional commitment. I'm not looking for you to get excited in the moment. He says, I'm looking for cold calculation from you. I'm looking for you to think about what I'm asking for and to make a decision that says, I am going to put it all on the line. My reputation, my relationships, I'm going to give everything. I want you to do it with cold calculation where you say, yes, this is worth it to me. I'm going to give my all to this cause. And it's so important that he repeats the idea again. Or what king, when he sets out to meet another king in battle, will not first sit down and take counsel whether he is strong enough with 10,000 men to encounter the one coming against him with 20,000? Or else while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks terms of peace. He says, count the cost. Before you enter the battle, count the cost. Don't be moved. Or he says, count the cost. And then when you commit, put it all on the line. And then verse 33. Jesus, he's not sparing any words here. So therefore, he says, no one of you can be my disciple who does not give up all his own possessions. So he says, look, your reputation, your relationships, count the cost. And it's not just there. He says, literally, all of your possessions need to be transferred into the kingdom of God. The ownership needs to be given to Jesus Christ. You need to see yourself as a steward and a manager and not the one who possesses yourself. Everything you have needs to be given to the Lord. Needs to be given over. He says, so therefore, no one can be my disciple who does not give up all his own possessions. Why is this so important? You know, in another place, Jesus says it's harder for a rich man to get into heaven than for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. And when he's saying that, he's not trying to say it's impossible for the rich to be saved. What he's trying to say is this: you cannot experience what I want you to experience unless you transfer ownership of everything to the kingdom of God. And it's just more difficult, it's more challenging the more you have. See, possessions, every possession has like a gravity to it. It has like a pull to it, every possession. And it pulls your life. It takes up time, it takes up energy. You know, this summer two of my children are returning back to our small town. Each of these, starting at 7 years old on down, each of them has four grandchildren. So I have this summer coming back into town, 8 grandchildren, 7 and under. Yeah. Yeah. Yep. I'm like totally thrilled and absolutely terrified. Okay, eight grandchildren, 7 and other. I mean, what in the world? And so we're trying to get the house ready for them. And my wife got this idea. She saw something and she bought this. It was like a teeter totter, kind of a thing. She wanted me to put together, and it came in a big box. It looked like an airplane, and the teeter totter is kind of the wings of the plane. And there's a place for you to sit if you fly in the plane. I think almost all 8 of them might be able to get on this thing at once. It's like quite a thing. And so anyway, so we get this big box shipped to us. Get this big box. On the outside of the box, it says can be assembled in 1 hour. assembled in 1 hour. I'm thinking to myself, wow, that's okay. That looks pretty good. 7 hours later, right? I'm thinking these people are not going to heaven. Whoever put that on that assembled in one, because liars are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. And this person is not going to heaven. I mean, there's just no way, right? So, there is no way. I mean, there was hundreds of bolts and, you know, all this stuff. So I put the thing all together, finally get all together, call my wife out of the house because she has to give the traditional, you know, that a boy, Mike, you know, you did it. And so I call her out of the house. Okay, honey, what do you say? What do you think? What do you think? You know, and, oh, it's beautiful. They'll like it. They'll like it. And I was feeling pretty good until I turned to the last page of the instructions. Because on the last page of the instructions, it said, now every week you need to tighten this bolt, and this bolt. And every month you need to lubricate this thing, and this thing. And every 6 months you need to, and I looked at this thing, I looked at my wife, I said, I thought we bought a teeter-totter. I said, we bought a life commitment here. This thing is taking over my life, you know, I putting it together, right? See, and that's the thing about possessions. Possessions, they have a pull on you, right? Everything you own has a pull on you. And Jesus says there's a remedy for that. And the remedy is you have to turn ownership over to me. And then, verse 34. Now, this is interesting, these couple of verses. Because remember, we're talking about commitment. And he begins to talk about salt here. But he says some things that was very confusing for many commentators for a long time because it doesn't appear to be true. Let's look at it and see what it says. Verse 34, he says, therefore, salt is good. But if even salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? It is useless either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. So salt is the attitude of total commitment that, you know, it's just the context of the passage. It's all clear. And he says, what if the salt becomes tasteless? Well, this was very confusing to people because one of the things about salt is that salt never changes, right? If you have a box of salt and you put it on the shelf and you come back 10 years later, what do you have?
Salt.
Box of salt, right? You never get the salt out and go, oh, this salt's lost its taste. You know, oh, this salt, you know, we're going to have to get some new salt. The salt's gone bad. You know, salt's turned bad, right? You never say that. You never say that because the salt never changes. So this did not appear to make sense. He says, the salt is good, but if even the salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? And they were confused until they began to study the historical situation and circumstance more, and then they began to understand. Because salt is a very, at this time, was a very expensive commodity. Salt had some tremendous benefits to it. You could use it for preserving food, which was very valuable. You could use it for medicinal purposes, which was also very valuable. Of course, we use it as a seasoning, which was also a great thing. And so it was very expensive. So if you were a merchant and you were carrying salt to a place, you might be tempted, and many did, to take the salt and to say, okay, I'm going to put something into the salt that looks like salt, but it's not salt, only maybe 10%. Now, immediately what would happen is my profits jump up 10%. And the person who's using it, if only 10% of it has changed, they're really not going to notice the difference. It's going to still taste very salty to them. And so this will be a way for me to improve my situation. And so they would cut the salt by 10%. Then you would buy the salt, and you'd bring the salt home, and you'd be sitting there with your container of salt, and you'd be thinking to yourself, wow, this stuff is expensive. If I let the kids get at this, they'll be shaking it all over everything. It's going to be gone so fast. I think I'm going to put a little something in the salt to make it last a little longer, right? Something that looks like salt, and I'll cut the salt again. And every time the salt would change hands, people would often cut the salt just a little bit until what would happen is eventually the salt would become what?
Tasteless.
See? The salt would become tasteless because it was no longer salt really any longer. And now remember, we're talking about commitment. And what Jesus is saying is this, is that in your life, you make a commitment, but that over time, often we compromise that commitment. In very small ways, you make a commitment to the Lord. Remember, salvation is something that is sure and secure, but your commitment has to be renewed. Commitment has to be renewed. So you've made a commitment at some point. It was a wholehearted, total commitment. But then over a period of time, it was cut with little compromises, until all at once the salt has become tasteless. Let me give you an example of this. You can see this idea more clearly. If we talk about children, for example, if I said to you, how many of you think a three-year-old child can experience Jesus Christ and make a commitment to the Lord? How many think that? Absolutely. Three-year-old child can make a commitment to the Lord. They make the commitment at the level that they are. At 3 years old, at that level, with what they understand, they can consecrate themselves to God. They can commit themselves to the Lord. It's a beautiful, precious thing. I hope all of you experience it in your families and in different ways. It's a beautiful thing, a small child's commitment to the Lord. But if you made a commitment to the Lord when you were three, what happens when you're 6 years old? Because when you become 6 years old, the world changes. There are new opportunities, and there are new temptations. And of course, what happens is that the three-year-old commitment is not enough to hold you when you're 6 years old, but now that you're 6 years old, you make a new commitment. And if you were six and made a commitment, and now you're 12 years old, how many of you realize that even though the commitment that you made when you were six was absolutely sincere and from the bottom of your heart, the fact is when you're 12, there's a whole big, broader world that you're dealing with all kinds of new opportunities and new temptations, and you've got to make a fresh commitment. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
And when you're 12, you become 18, and all at once, it's a whole big world again, right? And all at once, you need to... Remember, we're not talking about your salvation. We're talking about your commitment, your consecration, your total giving of yourselves to the kingdom and the purposes of God. And so this is the way it is. And it's not just affected by the years of a person's life. It's also affected by the different seasons of life. I can remember as a young man, kind of a newly minted minister. I was married, and my wife and I had a child of 4 years old, and I had been brought up in the inner city of Utica, New York, a city in upstate New York, and lived in a very kind of poor home environment. My father had left, you know, way early when I was just a little child, and nobody in my family had a car. You know, my mother didn't have a car, that kind of thing. And when I got to be at this age now, my wife and I, we bought our first new car. As a matter of fact, it was our one and only new car because it's such a lousy investment. But we went out and bought our first. We were just getting started, and we bought our first new car, right? And I can remember it very clearly. It was a 1984 Nissan Sentra wagon, and man, I just loved that car, you know, because I mean, you know, as a young guy, I'm out there and you know, here's the car in my driveway. My family didn't have a car, and now I have a car. I polish that baby and take care of it and just kind of love on it, you know, just a little bit. So anyway, one day I'm out there with my little son, Toby, 4 years old, little son Toby, and he's out there playing in the driveway, and he's got stones in his hands. For some reason, he's got to come tell me something. He's running across the driveway. He trips and he falls into the car, catches himself with his hands full of stones on the side of the car, and slowly falls down the side of the car. And I'm like, you know, look what you did. Go in the house. Go in the house right now. Toby's like, ooh. I'm like, go in the house, because I'm afraid I'm going to do something. You know what I mean? I'm like so shocked and so angry. And so he runs into the house, you know, with his mother, and I'm out there at the car. I'm going, look at that. That's right down the, you know, I'm just like beside myself for a little while. Finally, I calm down a little bit, and I'm kind of rubbing it. You know, I'm feeling bad. And all at once, the Lord speaks to me. And he says to me, he says, when did you start loving the car more than you loved your son? And I said, Lord, I don't love the car more than I love my son? He said, well, I couldn't tell by the way you just acted. He said, you seemed more concerned about the car than you did about your son's feelings or anything that was happening in the situation. You know, and I just felt, you know, I just felt, you know, that conviction, you know, just that, you know, this is not right. And so I decided, you know, I realized maybe this car had taken up a place in my life that it really wasn't supposed to take up. So I remember I just prayed, you know, and I gave the car to God. I transferred ownership. It was much easier to do now that the car was scratched up. You know what I mean? Before it was scratched, it was a little harder, you know, to get, really let it go. But now that it was kind of messed up a little bit, okay, it's yours. You know, it's, you know, giving it to you, you know, and I gave the car to the Lord. So what I want you to see here is that with a new season of life, a new commitment was required of me. Does that make sense to you? This is an important idea, and it goes on, you know, through your life. Sometimes it can be your career, you know, where your career is demanding something of you that is a compromise of who you are and who you are in Christ and that kind of thing, and you have to make the decision. Am I gonna be a person who moves forward in this career, or am I gonna be a person who stands by who I am in Jesus Christ? And we already talked about the idea of our children. Children come along, and we can come to a place where we love our children more than God, or our grandchildren, you know? I gave my son, my oldest son, Toby, the little guy who wrecked the car, he's a missionary in China. And I gave him to the Lord when he was little. It was easy. He was, like, really not so good. You know, he's kind of a bad kid. But I gave him to the Lord when he was a child. But I never gave my grandchildren to the Lord, and yet the Lord took them, you know. And maybe God's dealing with you about your grandchildren, you know, it's something. Or maybe it's retirement. Maybe you're one of those people who somehow bought into the idea that your retirement was about you doing what you wanted to do. All forgetting that years before you had made a commitment to Jesus Christ, that you had been bought with a price, the blood of Jesus Christ, and you had said to the Lord, I'll go anywhere you want me to go, I'll do anything you want me to do, I'll be anything you want me to be, except when I turn 65, then I'm going to do what I want to do. You with me? And all at once you come to the realization that, wow, that commitment can't be compromised. My retirement really isn't about me. It's about what is God's purposes, what's his calling, what's this new season, this new phase of my life. You know, when my kids were small, two of them are missionaries in China. One is a businessman. And when they were small, I would tell them stories about commitment and following the Lord. One of my favorite stories we would tell was the story of the Moravian missionaries. I don't know if you've ever heard the story of the Moravians, but it was an amazing movement. Started just like your church here, a consecrated group in a community, and they just began to take on a burden and reaching out and planting churches and then a burden for the nations of the world. And these Moravians were so intense in their love for Jesus. As a matter of fact, there's a whole season, moment in church history that is very well known, where the Moravians started a prayer meeting that lasted for 100 years, 24 hours a day, for 100 years. It was just a great revival prayer meeting that went on for 100 years. And of course, people who are spending that kind of time in the presence of the Lord, they get burdened with what God is burdened for, and they developed a tremendous love for the lost. And there's a story told about two Moravian young men. One was a carpenter, one was a potter. And they had a burden to minister to the slaves of the West Indies. But they didn't have the resources to be able to go to the West Indies to minister to this group. And they prayed and prayed, asking God for what his strategy was. And finally, they felt like the Lord spoke to them. And they made this decision to sell themselves into slavery so that they could be carried by the slavers to the West Indies, where they would be able to minister the gospel to those in the West Indies, and the slaves particularly. And so they made this decision, and now they're getting ready to be taken. They're in a boat on a ship in the Copenhagen harbor in Denmark, and they they're they're um, their families and friends have gathered on the dock, and the ship is getting ready to pull away in the fog. And these two guys know that every person that is out on that dock has one question in their mind. And the question is, why in the world are you doing this? And they were on the ship, and as the ship began to pull away, history tells us, they stood on the deck of that ship, and they looked out at their friends and their family, and they said this. This is what they said. They were answering the unsaid question. To win for the Lamb the reward of his suffering. That's why we're doing this. To win for the Lamb the reward of his suffering. Two and a half years ago, my son and his wife and their, at that time, three children, they have four now who are missionaries in China, they came home for 5 weeks. They had been gone for over 2 years at that time, and they came home for 5 weeks, and we were so excited to have them home for that 5 weeks. It was like, it was just, we just had the most fun. We had picnics in the backyard. And it was really neat because it just happened to work out. It was one of these rare moments where my other son was also in town. And my daughter, who is also a missionary in China, she was there also. So we were all there. This kind of thing just hardly ever happens. You know, we were all there together again. And oh, we had the greatest time laughing and fun and doing stuff together. And just, it was the greatest time. And finally, it came down to the end of the 5 weeks. And it was the Sunday before the Tuesday when they would be getting on the plane to head back to China. So it's Sunday night. We've spent the whole day together, all the family. We're just having the most fun. And finally, it's getting dusk. And my middle son says to my oldest son, Todd, speaking to Toby, he says, hey, listen, I'm not going to be able to be at the airport when you leave on Tuesday because I'm leaving on a business trip tomorrow. He said, so this is goodbye for us. Now, the thing is, we hadn't been thinking goodbye. You know what I mean? Goodbye is Tuesday. This is like happy day Sunday, you know, be together. And my son walked across the room, and he put his arms around his big brother. And they began to hug. And before we knew it, they were crying. You know, they started crying. And then, of course, after they started crying, everybody else started crying, you know. So we're all crying now, right? It was supposed to be happy days. And it's like we're all crying. And they're saying goodbye. And they're brothers. You know, some brothers, they don't care that much for each other. But these guys, they loved each other. They love each other. And so they're hugging and saying goodbye. And so finally, everybody leaves. Everybody leaves. It's dark. They all go home, put the kids to bed and stuff like that. And I look over at my wife, and I say to her, there is no way I am going to the airport on Tuesday. I said, I can't do it. You know, one of the kids, one of my grandkids, is this little, at that time, she was 4 years old. She looked like Shirley Temple. Blonde, curly, blonde hair, little Shirley Temple right there. And she was old enough to realize that the last 5 weeks she had been with both sets of grandparents and had been like the princess of the universe, right? For 5 weeks, you imagine, you know, coming home, stuff like that. And they wanted to bring her back to China, you know? And I could just picture us in the airport, and we're waving goodbye, and they're carrying her through security, and she's reaching back to me going, Grandpa, Grandpa, save me! Don't let them take me, you know? And I just said to myself, there is no way. I can't handle it. I can't do it. I can't go. I just can't do it. So Monday night, we go over to the house where they're staying, and we love on them, and we're very careful to keep all the emotions in check because we don't want to freak the kids out, and okay, it's goodbye. We'll see you. Oh, we're going to come visit, you know, we'll see you. Goodbye. And we come back home. And then Tuesday morning comes, and I'm sitting at the kitchen table, and I know that they're getting on the plane right then. And I just feel a terrible sense of loss. And I get a text from my son. And in the text, he says this, about to leave for Shanghai. He says, why do we do this again? ... And I'm thinking to myself, I don't know why we do these things. This is crazy. Why are we doing this? I don't know. ... And then he writes, to win for the Lamb the reward of his suffering. To win for the Lamb the reward of his suffering. And he says, I'll miss you, Dad. I'll miss you too, Toby. To win for the Lamb the reward of his suffering. Brothers and sisters, I don't know what the Lord is speaking to you about, but is it possible that the commitment that once was pure salt has been cut, has been compromised? And that even though, yes, your salvation is real, it's been in your life, the fact is there's a renewal of commitment that needs to take place in your life. There's a fresh giving of all, your reputation, your possessions, your relationships. There's a fresh yielding to the Lord that he's calling for you to have. Has the salt become tasteless in your life? Because it doesn't have to be tasteless. It can be renewed. It can be renewed. You can do it, see? You can do it. You can make it pure again. A pure, wholehearted commitment. Well, right now we're going to have communion, and Pastor's going to lead us in a time just of freshly committing ourselves to the Lord.
Let's give the Lord a hand for that word. Amen. It's so good.